Thank you, Lord. Thank you so much for your grace, your mercy, and your love, Lord. We just give it all to you today and always. Today, guys, it's all about breakthrough. We're gonna sing when we're weary. We're gonna sing when we're happy. We're just gonna sing. We're gonna sing for the people in the streets, for the people that need to know Jesus. I am weary from the waves crashing over every day. God of mercy, please come rescue me. I am longing for your voice, gentle whisper in the noise. Father, tell me everything's all right. Your power, your presence breaks strongholds, King of heaven. When you speak, mountains move. I believe there will be breakthrough. You alone can take my scars. Peace by peace, restore my heart. Take what's broken, make it whole again. Oh, your power, your presence breaks strongholds, King of heaven. When you speak, mountains move. I believe there will be breakthrough. There will be breakthrough. Shake the mountains, break the walls apart, open the heavens. Almighty God, you are overcomer, defender of my heart. It's who you are, God. Oh, and by your power, oceans open wide, your fire falls down, heaven and earth collide. King Jesus, forever by my side. Oh, yeah. Shake the mountains, break the walls apart, open the heavens. Almighty God, you are overcomer, defender of my heart. By your power, by your power, yeah. And by your power, the oceans open wide, your fire falls down, heaven and earth collide. King Jesus, forever by my side. I believe there will be breakthrough. this morning we're going to open with the good news, God's heavenly throne room. In Revelation chapter 4, we receive a glimpse of the majesty of God's throne room. With powerful imagery, we see God's glory. We see the destiny of his church. We witness his power and authority, and we get a sense of the expanse of his eternal realm. On the throne, one, the Father of glory is seated on his throne. God is glorious, and his glory shines with the purity of a multifaceted diamond. God's throne is far above any other throne. Around the throne, 24 elders. The church has a heavenly destiny. Here, the church is represented by the elders around the throne of God. The church is God's church. From the throne, lightning and thundering. Like flashes of lightning and sounds of thunder, God's awesome power and complete authority are on display. God's wrath is a righteous wrath. Before the throne, a sea. Like a sea which reaches beyond the horizon in every direction, God's kingdom goes on and will live on forever. God's kingdom is an eternal kingdom. Our God is great and glorious God. Thank him for the goodness today, Christian. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King that conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy.
So my intentions as we studied the churches of Revelation were to extract some of the many spiritual riches written there. Have you received any spiritual riches from our study? And then we seek to make application of the things that we've learned. Are you attempting? Are you trying? Are you praying that God would help you apply the things that we've learned? Then we see where the Lord would have us go next. So the intention was I was going to go through the seven churches of Revelation and see where the Lord leads us. Well, last week we stayed in Revelation because we all know that the seven churches end at chapter 3. We went into chapter 4, and we were in chapter 4 on Revelation's spiritual highway, if you will. And we moved from the seven churches and we went into God's throne room, and we just read the good news, and that was a review of where we were in chapter 4 last week. And we learned that Jesus instructed the Apostle Paul to write three things down. In chapter 1, Jesus told the Apostle Paul, write these three things down. The first thing he said to write down were the things which you've seen, and we've discovered that he was talking about, you've seen me, I'm revealing myself to you, write what you see about me. And then he said, the second thing I want you to write down was the things which are, and that was chapters 2 and 3, that's the seven churches. And he says the things that are, because are you the church? We are the church. And so he says, I want you to write down the state of the church. And that letter was written around 2,000 years ago. And the state of the church remains the same. I hate to say it, because there are some good things and some not so good things. So the things that we learned about the seven churches, we can see, because we are the church, some of us in those seven churches. And the third thing that he instructed the Apostle Paul to write, he says, and the things which will take place after this. After what? After chapter 3. What is chapter 3? It reveals the churches. There's the age of the church. We are the church. We are in the age of the church. And this age will one day pass away. And so what Jesus tells Paul, John, is he says, I want you to write what's going to happen after the age of the church. And that's what we started in chapter 4. We got a glimpse into the throne room of God. He said, this is what's going to happen after the age of the church passes away. So last week we entered God's throne room, and the scene was God the Father seated on his throne, and we got a glimpse of his throne, around the throne, what was coming from the throne, and what was set before the throne. And we just read, the good news, and that kind of explained that. That was chapter 4. And in chapter 5, what happens is we stay in the throne room, but there's a very dynamic thing that happens, because as dynamic and powerful and beautiful and glorious and amazing as that scene was with the Father seated on the throne and all these things, the 24 elders and all these things going on around them, the thunderings and lightnings and the diamonds and the rainbows and all those things going on, as amazing as that was happening, but there's a move that's going to happen in chapter 5, and then there's an exchange, and there's a very important exchange. And we teach three things here: application, application, and application. So me, as I asked the Lord, where do you want us to go? He said, well, we're going to see the glory of Jesus revealed here. How does that apply to my life at this moment? What application can I draw out of that? I'm here to tell you, the more you know about Jesus, the more you'll worship Jesus. The more we understand who he is and his power and his authority and his realm, the more we will appreciate him and call on him and allow him to be our Lord. Do we have any Christians? He's already your Savior. If you're a Christian, he's already your Savior. But the question I want to ask you this morning for your own contemplation, is he your Lord? Is he your King? It's one thing to call him Savior. If you're a believer, he is your Savior. But is he your King? Is he your Lord? Because if he's your King, we walk in obedience. We walk in submission. And we come to an understanding of who he is. And for us to get there, and some of us, maybe you struggle with that Lord thing, that God thing, that transition from Savior to my King. I think it goes a long ways if we come to a deeper, everybody say deeper, a deeper, more profound revelation of who Jesus is. The title of this message is The Lion, The Lineage, and The Lamb. We're going to be in the throne room again, and we're going to see something happen there in the throne room. And we started in chapter 4 of the throne room last week. This week we'll be in chapter 5. Father, speak to us today. We want to hear from you today, Father. Reveal a little bit more of Jesus today. We want to see a little more of Jesus today, Lord, that we may come into a deeper revelation, a deeper understanding, a deeper appreciation of your mighty, great Son. In the name of your Son, we pray. There are 36 names or titles in the book of Revelation for Jesus. And each identifies one of his attributes or expresses one of his missions, one of his appointments. As the Apostle John writes what he has seen, the things that are, and the things which will take place, he sometimes uses imagery to express what is being shown to him. In chapter 5, John sees Jesus, and the only one in the whole universe who has the authority to take the scroll from the Father's hand. Jesus is going to enter into the scene. See, last week we saw the Father on the throne. Now Jesus is going to enter in, and there's a transfer there. And that's what we're going to look at in chapter 5. Sealed with seven seals, the scroll, when opened, would reveal God's secret plans and purposes for his church and for the world. With the transfer of the scroll, we see four realms of Jesus's authority. So we're going to see four different realms of Jesus's authority. Because taking the scroll, because we're going to see there's only one authorized, one has the authority to take that scroll from the Father's hand. And so we're going to see Jesus as the Lion, which represents authority over nations. Then we're going to see the lineage of Jesus, which means authority over the kings of the world. And then we're going to see the Lamb means authority over death. Revelation chapter 5, we pick it up in verse 1, and it says, and I saw in the right hand, why the right hand? The right hand means the authority hand, the power side, the authority side. And I saw in the right hand of him, this is the Father, who sat on the throne, a scroll written inside and on the back, sealed with seven seals. In biblical times, that was a common way of preparing legal documents, and they were sealed and nobody could open them unless you were authorized. And generally you had the front side was like the general thing and the fine print was rolled up on the inside on the back, right? And so it's a legal document. This is a spiritual binding, legal document. Verse 2, then I saw a strong angel. Some people believe that's Gabriel, the archangel. Then I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the scroll and to loose its seals? And no one in heaven or on the earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or even look at it. This is John. So I wept much because no one was found worthy to open and read the scroll or to look at it. Why would John weep? This was a man who pursued God with everything he had, the Apostle John. He lived for pursuing God, and here he is. Jesus is revealed to him, and he's starting to show him the destiny of the world, the destiny of the church, and the mysteries of God, and then all of a sudden there's a ceiling. So he weeps, and he breaks his heart, because I want to know more of you, God. You've shown me this much, why can't I see more? So it makes him weep. Does anybody want more of God today? So I wept. Verse 5. But one of the elders, who are the elders? We learned last week, that's the representatives of the church. One of the elders said to me, do not weep. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has prevailed. What did Jesus say to one of the seven churches? He says, you need to prevail just as I've prevailed and ascended to the right hand of my Father. Jesus prevailed that you might prevail. Who has prevailed to open the scroll and to loose its seven seals. And I look, and behold, in the midst of the throne and of the four living creatures, and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb as though it had been slain. We just sang it. A lamb as though it had been slain, having seven horns. Seven horns, when the Bible talks about horns, it means authority and power. Kings are represented as horns. And the seven means complete. So it means complete power, complete kingness, complete power of a king, and seven eyes. Seven eyes means that he can see everything all the time, which are the seven spirits of God sent into all the earth. Why would Jesus be revealed to John like that? We have to understand that the Bible uses a lot of imagery. In our culture, what do we say when it rains a lot? It's raining cats and dogs out there. Now, we know that there's not cats and dogs falling out of the sky, but we know that's a term that we use to describe a reality. And somebody from another country said, they're crazy in America. They said there's cats and dogs falling out of the sky. See, we have to understand that they're using imagery here. Amen? Amen? Not always. Here. Okay? Then he, Jesus, this is identifying Jesus. He came and took the scroll out of the right hand of him who sat on the throne. Now, when he had taken the scroll from the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. Hey, look at there. Remember, look in chapter 4, verse 10. What were they doing? They were worshiping the Father, and now they turn and start worshiping the Son. Amen? So now they bow before the Lamb, each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. Do we have any people that pray? Our prayers are like a sweet aroma to our Father in heaven. And they sang a new song. Let's pause there. I want to look at three things. We see this is Jesus identified, and we see him identified first as a lion from the tribe of Judah. The lion represents authority over nations. The Lion of Judah expresses the overwhelming power of Jesus as the world conqueror. Jesus is coming back. How many know that Jesus is coming back? First time he came as a lamb. He came in submission as the humble servant, but he's coming back as the conquering hero. Revelation 19:11-16 says that Jesus is coming back as the ultimate world conqueror, and that he will rule the nations of the earth. Jesus is God's conquering lion. So we talk about the Lion of Judah. What is the Lion of Judah? What is that a reference to? That's a reference to the Old Testament. We have the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, father, son, grandson from Abraham. And Jacob had 12 sons, and those 12 sons are the roots of the 12 tribes of Israel. And so who is the Lion of Judah? Let's go there. Let's just go quickly over there. Go to Genesis chapter 49. Genesis chapter 49, if you would. That's way back at the beginning of the Bible. Genesis chapter 49. And this is Jacob. He's about to die. And in chapter 49, if you want to go and read it at another time, you'll see he'll give a blessing and a prophecy to his 12 sons. He's lying in his deathbed, and they come, and he tells them, and he reminds them, and he says that because of you did this, and you're gonna, there's a fruit that you're gonna, that your ancestors after you are gonna reap. And to Judah specifically is where I want to go. So the third son down in verse 8, you'll see Judah. This is one of the 12 sons of Jacob. Genesis 49:8 says, Judah, you are whom your brothers shall praise. Your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies. This is a warrior clan. There are warriors in the wilderness wanderings. Judah, the tribe of Judah, was the biggest and the most powerful and the best fighters. They were the warrior clan, and they would always go ahead of the rest of the children of Israel and clear the way because they were the warriors. Your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies. He means they're warriors. Your father's children shall bow down before you. Judah is a lion's whelp. What's a lion's whelp? A whelp is like a roar. Judah is a lion's roar from the prey. My sons, you have gone up. He bows down. He lies down as a lion. And as a lion, who shall rouse him? Don't mess with the sleeping lion. Amen? Don't mess with the sleeping lion. The scepter. What's a scepter? A scepter is like a wand. It means a king. A king has the wand, and he could anoint people or commission people with that wand. He carries it. That's a symbol of his authority. The scepter, that wand, shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet. Here it is. Until Shiloh comes. Who's Shiloh? Shiloh, that's a wordplay. That's a Hebrew compilation of different verbs and nouns, and it represents Jesus. Until Shiloh comes, and to him, Shiloh, Jesus, here that we're reading it over here in Revelation, and to him shall be the obedience of the people. What's that talking about? Jesus is coming back. The Bible says that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and power. There's a spiritual battle that Jesus has won. There's also a physical battle. Jesus is going to conquer the world. Amen? Amen. So that's what that's talking about. When you go back here, go back to Revelation again. Am I losing anybody yet? It said, so the lion here that we, again, it says, verse 5, but one of the elders said to me, do not weep, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Identify as Jesus, he is able. Then he said, calls him something else. Then he calls him the root of David. He's talking about Jesus here. So what's the root of David? The root of David means the lineage. Last week, or actually a few weeks ago, we were talking about Jesus was writing to one of the churches in the seven churches, and he said, I have the key of David, the key of David. And that means basically the same thing. It means I have authority to the throne of David via the Davidic covenant. If you go to the Old Testament, you see God promises David a descendant would fulfill his throne as the king. And you'll see his son Solomon fulfills it short term, but long term, the ultimate fulfillment of the Davidic covenant is Jesus. Amen? Jesus is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. How many know that? Jesus is the King of kings and the Lord of the root of David identifies Jesus as the rightful heir to the throne of King David according to God's covenant, which promised from the blood of David would come the blood of the Christ. The blood of the Christ. Jesus conquered death with the blood he shed at the cross. Jesus is the king by the blood that flowed through his veins. Revelation 19:16 identifies Jesus as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Jesus is the anointed king. Does everybody know what anointed means? Anointed means one who is set up, who is set apart by God for his purposes. Anointed means one who has been commissioned by God. When we talk about Jesus being the anointed one, what's his anointing? To be the Messiah, the Savior of the world. And part of his anointing was that he would die on the cross and raise again. Jesus is the anointed king. You know, we've been talking about this for 10 years. Jesus is the king. Jesus is the king. Jesus is the king. But here we're looking into the future, where if we see that Jesus is going to assume the throne, he's going to take the scroll here in chapter 5. Why have we been calling him the king all along? This is looking into the future. Because Jesus is the king. Amen. The things that God says will be, sometimes he expresses them as they already are. Because if God says it, it's going to happen, it's as good as already happened. Jesus is the king. The lion represents authority over the nations. That's the Lion of Judah. The lineage of the root of David represents authority over all kings. How about the lamb? It's what we were just reading a little while ago. And we see that in verse 6. He says, "And I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne and of the four living creatures, and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb as though it had been slain." Slain, but it's still standing. Amen. "Having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent into all the earth." What is that? Remember Jesus, he promised the disciples. He says, "I'm going to go in my house, in my Father's house, there's many mansions. I'm going to go prepare a place for you." And in the book of Acts, he said, "Don't leave until I send the Holy Spirit." He said, "You don't set out about building my church until you're empowered with the Holy Spirit." And so what he's saying here, the Holy Spirit has been sent out into all the earth. Through who? Through you. Are you a believer? If you're a Christian, the Holy Spirit dwells in you, and we're called to take the Holy Spirit into all the world. Amen? So it says here that the Holy Spirit has been sent out into all the earth. Jesus sent him. He said, "I'm going to send the Comforter." Jesus sent him. He says, "I'm going to send the Holy Spirit." The lamb means authority over death. A lamb as though it were slain is Jesus, the Lamb of God who conquered death, and he rose from the grave. Amen. In Revelation 2:8, Jesus says that he was dead and has come back to life. Is this speaking to anybody out there? 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And there's something there that we really need to look at. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. This whole section of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the Apostle Paul, who's the writer of this letter to the church in Corinth, he's pushing back against those who said there is no resurrection. And he starts saying, well, if there's no resurrection, that means Jesus didn't rise. And if Jesus didn't rise, we're just wasting our time here. Why are we doing church? Why are we preaching the word? Why are we sharing the gospel? Why are we proclaiming Jesus if he did not rise? Because if he did not rise, then he says, we are the most pitiful of people. He says, and our faith is empty, and our preaching is empty, because if Jesus did not rise, our faith is a lie, and Jesus is not whom he proclaimed, who he professed to be. Then he says, but Jesus did rise. Everybody say, but Jesus did rise. Jesus did rise, and that's the foundation of our faith. In 1 Corinthians here in 47, I'm not going to read that whole section. And let's go to 47. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 47. The first man, he's talking about Adam, was of the earth made of dust. And the second man is Jesus, is the Lord from heaven. One came from the earth, the dust. One came from heaven. Verse 51. He says, okay, Corinthians, church, I've established that Jesus rose. You need to believe that Jesus rose, or else you're not really a Christian. And if you do, he He says, behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep. What sleep? He's talking about dying. Not everybody's going to die. But we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. At the last trumpet. What is a trumpet? We're going to look at it real quickly a little bit later. What is at the last trumpet? For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible and shall be changed. For this corruptible, my body's corruptible, man. I'm telling you, I feel it every morning. I know my body's corruptible. I wake up and aches and pains, and my hair is getting thinner and all these things, and all these things are happening. Why? Because we have a corruptible container that our spirit inhabits. But he said, we're going to lay that corruptible container, that corruptible body aside. He said, and we're going to take up the incorruptible. That's the glorified you. You too, like we're seeing Jesus glorified. You too, as a Christian, are one day going to be glorified. So when the corruptible has put on the incorruptible and this mortal body has put on the immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O death, where is your sting? Jesus is the Lamb of God. And when he says, as the Lamb that was slain and is standing and he's resurrected, he conquered death. So death is now nothing but a fly, because a bee without a stinger has no power. It's just a fly. See, he's saying death used to have power over us and he would sting us because he had a stinger. But now, because Jesus, the Lamb of God that was slain, has conquered death, death is merely a fly that annoys us and we can swat it away. Amen? That's really good news if you've lost a loved one. That's really good news. Why? Go to 1 Thessalonians. Hang in there with me. Hang in there with me, you guys. You guys hanging in there? 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, 13 says, but I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep. If you've lost a loved one, this is for you. Those who have fallen asleep, those who have passed away, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. Are you a Christian this morning? You have hope. You have hope because it says the world who doesn't have Jesus, who they have no hope because death is just death. But we as believers, we have the hope. So we are to celebrate life. Amen? Even when our hearts are broken. Verse 14. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring him with him those who have sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord. By the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are falling asleep. If we go back to 1 Corinthians, what did Paul say? He said, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all die. Some of us will be alive. Somebody's going to be alive, and Jesus is going to come the second time, and then we will never experience death because Jesus came before we had a chance to die. Does that make sense to you? Yeah. Verse 16, for the Lord himself would descend from heaven with a shout and the voice of an archangel and the trumpet. There's that trumpet again. And the trumpet of God and the dead in Christ will rise first. Does that make sense to you? If you lost a loved one, God promises that those who are the believers, he's going to raise them up in glory. Amen? Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds and meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Now that's talking about the rapture, okay? What does the trumpet mean? Here we just, the Bible as Revelation continues, is going to talk about seals. Remember the Lamb of God, there's that contract, there's that the scroll, and there's seven seals. And we're going to see as it goes, Jesus is going to peel one seal, and the seal reveals what's written inside. This is what God says about this. So there's seven seals. As he opens a seal, there's more of a revelation of God, what God's going to do. And then there's trumpets. The seal reveals what God's going to do. The trumpet reveals, oh, it's on. You know that seal that I told you about, that thing I told you about? Now the trumpet announces it's here. And then it's going to have bowls. Now, what's a bowl? A bowl is, okay, you had the seal. It was sealed up. The trumpet announces, watch out, the bowl is going to be poured out. And the bowl is going to be poured out. And that's God's wrath or God's judgment upon the earth. So we have seals, trumpets, and bowls. As we're not going to go through all that. We're going to do a cursory kind of thing and mention it. Just so you know, if you continue reading Revelation, understand that there's seals, there's trumpets, and there's bowls. But I want to look at one trumpet. Revelation chapter 11. Is this speaking to anybody out there? Revelation chapter 11. The seventh trumpet. There's seven seals. There's seven trumpets. And there's seven bowls. Here's the seventh trumpet. Then the seventh angel sounded, what? Sounded the trumpet. And there was a loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of the world have become the kingdoms of our Lord. What was that? We have been, for 10 years in this church, we've been saying, Jesus is the king, Jesus is the king, Jesus is the king. Here's where it comes into fruition. The kingdoms of the world have been given over to the Son here at this point. The kingdoms of the world have become the kingdoms of the Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Amen. Our glimpse into God's throne room reveals a heavenly scene. God the Father on his throne, Jesus the Son approaching and taking a sealed scroll from his hand, and all the creation breaks out in a celebration of praise. Go back to chapter 5 and you'll see every creature under the earth, on top of the earth, every angel, every being in God's creation starts worshiping Jesus. Amen. Here we see Jesus receiving all authority from the Father. How amazing it is that in heaven, Jesus would receive the fruit of the things that he did here on earth. Philippians says that because of what Jesus did, because he came down out of heaven and died on the cross and was crucified on the cross, Jesus, the Father raised him up and gave him a name which is above every other name, that every tongue should confess and every tongue would bow before Jesus as king. And when did he do those works? He did that here on earth. He did these things on earth. And he received the reward in heaven. How about you? How about me? Amen. Like Jesus, we too are promised crowns of rewards in our heavenly destiny. If, everybody say if. Yes. If we persevere as he has persevered. Here's a point. Live life, Christian, in preparation. Live this life in preparation for the next life. The Bible says this life is but a breath. We're just passing through, everybody. We're just passing through. And it breaks my heart. I know people in my circles of family and friends and relationships who are going through so much heartache right now. And there's people right now who are locked and afraid to go outside the door. They're afraid to go to the store. They're afraid to get too close to somebody. And for whatever reason that is, legitimate or not legitimate, that's not the point. There's people with broken hearts. There's people who are isolated. There's people who are growing lukewarm. There's Christians who are going from lukewarm to dead. And that breaks my heart. So what do we do? How is the application? What is the application of seeing Jesus like this, seeing a bigger revelation of Jesus? What should our application be?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Woo! Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You sing for all that you've done for me. Into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. Let's give it up to Jesus. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing. Oh,